Again, my name is Anna Eskamani, and I'm proud to serve District 47 in the Florida Legislature. For those who don't know, District 47 includes downtown Orlando, Winter Park, Belle Isle, and Edgewood. And my pronouns are she, her, hers. And I'm the daughter of working class immigrants from Iran, born and raised in Orlando. And my entry into activism was with Planned Parenthood. I went to Orange County Public Schools, where I experienced absence-only education that left me feeling disempowered and angry. And the fact that we were not being given accurate information to make informed decisions about our bodies and about our lives, that I find myself at a Planned Parenthood Health Center when I was 18 years old looking for answers, and I left with a method of contraception that was right for me. And from there, I went to the University of Central Florida, go Knights, where I started getting really involved as a campus organizer. I would volunteer at Planned Parenthood as a health center escort and spent many early mornings in the Florida heat and the sometimes cold in ensuring that our patients could walk into our health centers free of stigma, free of judgment, and could make decisions that were best for themselves and those that they love. And through that experience, I was hired at Planned Parenthood shortly before my graduation, and I worked there for 6 years, rising to be the Senior Director of Public Affairs and Communications at the Southwest Central Florida affiliate. So shout out to any board members or staff of my former affiliate, much love and respect. And really during that time, you developed a manifesto, if you will, of caring about these issues and of being abortion out loud. And so when I made the decision to run for office as a first-time candidate back in 2017, it was after the election of President Trump, which I'm so proud to see the inauguration of not only President Joe Biden, but the first ever woman of color vice president in office as in the executive branch. It's a historic moment for our country. But with that said, my decision to run for office was very much grounded on a desire to ensure that representation looked like us and representation cared about us. Because there were many moments where I would go to Tallahassee as a Planned Parenthood staffer with patients, sharing stories, sharing facts, demystifying contraception, reproductive health, destigmatizing abortion. And meanwhile, no matter how hard we worked, we would never have the votes. These issues fell on partisan lines. They were made to be sensational. They were made to judge and shame folks who ended their pregnancies. And it left me realizing that nothing would change unless we elected people like me. And I have to tell y'all, when I made a decision to run for office, being an abortion out loud advocate, which for me means we're going to talk about abortion not just when it's politically in crisis, but all the time, because abortion is essential. Abortion is healthcare. It has to be intertwined into the conversation of reproductive health rights and justice. I want to make sure that no matter where you find yourself in this state or in this country, that if you are faced with a pregnancy, you can make all decisions and do so without financial constraints. You should be able to decide to become a parent and end a pregnancy or raise a child without money even being a concern. And if you decide to become a parent, you should be supported in that endeavor with prenatal care, postnatal care, postpartum care. You should be able to have every option available to you in this state and in this country. And the reality is that we're not there. Black maternal mortality rates are way too high. Maternal mortality rates in general are way too high. So many of our Floridians find themselves in poverty because of parenthood, and that's not okay. And if you're a young person who becomes pregnant, if you want to become a young parent, you should, and you should be supported. But if you also choose adoption or choose to end that pregnancy, you should not have barriers placed in front of you, and you should not be judged and shamed through nonsensical laws like parental consent and notification that are purely designed to shame young people, not empower them. And I say it time and time again, if our opponents truly want to reduce the rate of abortion, then guess what? We have options. We have the option to invest in comprehensive sexual health education. We have the option of increased access to contraception. We have the option to ensure that that these resources can be available in different languages, and we can invest in public health. Title 10, the nation's family planning program, is going to crisis pregnancy centers right now. We have the options to set this country and this state on a track of bodily autonomy and a reproductive justice, but it takes the right people to do it. And when I made the decision to run for office, it was not easy, in the sense that establishment folks thought that my work at Planned Parenthood would be a liability. And little did they realize that it was a strength, that every person who put a yard sign for us in their neighborhood did so knowing my work at Planned Parenthood, appreciating my work at Planned Parenthood, and respecting personal medical decisions. And the number of folks that would pull me off the street to tell me their abortion story, to tell me the experience that they had, sometimes whisper it to me in coffee shops for fear of other people hearing it, is why it is so important that we are bold, that we are loud, that we are unbossed and unapologetic about these issues. Now, this is the 48th anniversary of Roe v. Wade, but I want to be clear, y'all. Even with Roe v. Wade as the law of the land, abortion is still not available to every person. Whether it's language barriers, cost barriers, transit barriers, geographical barriers, we know that the status quo ain't cutting it. And yet, instead of looking at ways to expand access to reproductive health and rights and justice, politicians are very keen at rolling it back. And even with a Democratic White House, we have to realize that on the ground in Florida, things are not better. We have Republican trifecta in the House, Senate, in the judicial branch, and in the executive branch. And with a more conservative state Supreme Court, abortion access is on the line in the Sunshine State. You know, it has been our state constitution that has protected abortion access, where laws like 24-hour mandatory delay have been stopped by the Supreme Court of Florida, not the US, of Florida. And so we have to do whatever we can to protect that right to privacy and to push back against lawmakers that continue to shame and stigmatize us. Remember, abortion access is not just a health issue, it's also an issue of dignity and humanity. And it's critically important that any person who finds themselves in situations around their body, around pregnancy, that they be supported, they be empowered, and they have all options in front of them. So continue on this great work. Know that we are fighting alongside you in the legislature, in the streets, in our neighborhoods, sharing stories. And to those who will be sharing their stories tonight, I just want you to know that I am grateful for you. Storytelling is transformational. It does change a person's life and perspective. I will tell you one quick story and then I'll toss it back to our facilitators. When I was working at Planned Parenthood, we had expanded a new health center in Osceola County in Kissimmee. And that's where my office was for years, was doing whatever we could to protect this health center and ensure folks knew we were there for them. And I remember attending an event with the Osceola County Chamber. And I made it very, very intentional that I wanted to participate in spaces where other nonprofits were, because I wanted folks to take us seriously as a legitimate, credible, and impactful nonprofit organization. And I remember meeting someone there who recognized me from the newspaper. And I used to write this 100-word column looking at the week ahead. And a lot of my commentary was reproductive health oriented. So he told me that my commentary, my storytelling, my explanation changed his perspective on abortion access. So don't think your work doesn't matter. Don't think your stories don't matter. Please realize that it is powerful when you speak out and when you advocate for yourself and those that you care about. Thank you again, y'all. Let's continue the work. Let's stay focused on the future and let's go beyond Roe v. Wade. Thank you.